So now we can commence the talks for the evening, and it is my job to present. So the first speaker comes to us from Holy Cross, which is in Fort Lauderdale, and his name is Dr. Charles Russo. So Dr. Charles Russo went to medical school in New York Medical College. After that, he received his internal medicine residency from Hartford Hospital in Connecticut. He then went on to do a fellow in cardiology at the University of Miami Jackson Memorial Hospital, where he was also chief resident. He has multiple certifications and multiple appointments since then. He is certified in lipidology, nuclear cardiology. He held some appointments, including chief of staff at Northridge Medical Center. He is also, or was also, sorry, assistant clinical professor of medicine at the University of Miami. That's amongst a few of the ones that he had. He is accredited by the American Board of Clinical Lipidology, the National Board of Medicine Examiners, National Board of Internal Medicine, National Board of Internal Medicine Cardiology, Fellow of the American College of Cardiology, and Certifying Council of Nuclear Cardiology. And today, the title of his talk will be Advanced Cardiac Therapeutics in a Community Hospital Setting. So here is Dr. Charles Russo.
Thank you, Dr. Baraha, and thank you for inviting me to this event, and hopefully you'll be entertained by the talk. The title of it was Advanced Cardiac Therapeutics in a Community Hospital Setting, but it's really going to finish with cardiogenetics. First, I just wanted to introduce Holy Cross Hospital, which is part of Trinity Health. Trinity Health is 92 hospitals. That's how it spreads across the country, basically. It's the fourth largest hospital chain in the United States at this point. Holy Cross Hospital itself has many specialties, greater than 30 plus. It has about 560 beds, and our Holy Cross Heart team has put together an advanced therapeutics clinic to meet the needs of our community. We got together as a cardiology group and decided that we needed to help the community in different ways. The first program that was actually started was the congestive heart failure program, and the reason for that was readmissions, basically. It's one of the most important conditions that people continually get readmitted to the hospital with. It's been a success, as you will see, but while we have interventional cardiology as well, we do heart failure, but we are a transplant referral center, as you'll see later on. We don't do transplants at the hospital. We do primarily in our clinic cardio-oncology. As you know, nowadays, many new drugs and genetic-based drugs are used to treat cancers, but they have cardiac side effects. We do pulmonary hypertension, adult congenital heart disease, cardiac resynchronization, as well as pulmonary hypertension in our clinic. For a community hospital, we do an awful lot of research. We're trying to bring the best studies to our patients early, and that's the reason why we do it. When you see the number of studies that we have for a community hospital, whether they're stent studies or heart failure studies or device studies, there's an awful lot for a community hospital, and we're very proud of that. I mean, it just goes on and on. Of course, we have cardiothoracic surgery, do the usual open heart procedures, as well as off-pump procedures. We have ECMO and Impella to help support circulation. We do transaortic valve replacements and have our interventional cardiology section with 1,500 diagnostic caths and 417 advanced procedures is also many things that we do. Our TAVR program has been in existence for greater than 4 years with about 175 different implants with a great morbidity and mortality. And it has advanced so that the size of the catheters have gone down to such a small size at this point that we can do things we couldn't do before. We do have regional alliances with multiple other hospitals, including Memorial and Jackson Health Center, and we do refer some complex cases there. We have some research trials involved in the cath lab. We're part of the Smart Care program, which is a program that the American College of Cardiology got funded from Medicare and Medicaid in Washington, and it takes place in six places in Florida, and I believe it's Wisconsin. And basically, it's a program to use evidence-based medical care to treat our patients and to raise the level and quality of care that we give. We have a brisk arrhythmia and electrophysiology services there with four electrophysiologists on staff, do multiple ablations. We have an atrial fibrillation ablation program, and our all of our heart programs are part of national registries. Everything is transparent with what we do. We have research trials for EP, congestive heart failure, as I said. We're part of a regional network between, for the whole state, actually. And it's a it's a complete program that's patient-centered, as you can see here. Patients get admitted with CHF, they're referred to the program. The program itself has won awards and is one of the flagship program that started our advanced therapeutic clinic, actually. But as you can see here, there's patient education, social support, risk assessment, multiple research trials with new pharmacotherapies, telemedicine, and the like. Cardiac imaging. We have state-of-the-art CTA. Actually, our radiologist who's in charge of CTA has written a textbook on CTA. We have cardiac MRI as well. And we were talking earlier today among ourselves about the fact that we couldn't do a lot of the advanced procedures that we're able to do without our radiology colleagues and their ability to do these 3D technologies. Echocardiography, of course, including 3D intracardiac echocardiography and stress echo. Adult congenital and structural program, which was just set up in conjunction with Memorial and Massachusetts General Hospital. As you know, we've made great advances in the last 50 years with open heart surgeries, and many of these children are now surviving to adulthood, and they have particular problems that need to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed in a specialty setting, and even in a super specialty setting, and we're proud that we have that program going on. Pulmonary hypertension program, again, a multidisciplinary program involving cardiology and pulmonary alike also. This is what I wanted to talk about to begin with. Cardiac genetics, genomics, and genetic testing, okay? And if you say, well, how is this going to happen? We're in the Cayman Islands. How does this work? As you'll see, basically, you can do some of this testing here and then refer out. It's actually very user-friendly, and genetics is where medicine is going to begin with. Oncology is already ahead of us in terms of that, and cardiology is close behind, and most universities have cardiogenetic and oncology genetic counseling centers already. So our DNA is where all our genes are stored in chromosomes, and the whole organism is controlled by that. The central dogma, as we remember from our medical school days, DNA is changed to RNA, which is changed to proteins, and those proteins can be structural or functional in nature, and they run everything in the body. Modes of inheritance, to keep it simple, there's autosomal dominant modes of inheritance, with one of the alleles being needed for expression, autosomal recessive, with two alleles needed for expression, X-linked dominant, where two alleles in a female is needed for expression, but it's usually lethal in a male, and X-linked recessive, generally only expressed in males. And an example of this would be Fabry's disease, which is generally not expressed in females, but only expressed in males with one X chromosome. Okay, there's, of course, the genotype, which is, and the phenotype, and they're related in that they're highly dependent. The genotype is the phenotype will be highly dependent on the penetrance of the gene and the expressivity, which can also be highly variable. For instance, when we talk about sudden death and long QT syndrome, it can have, depending on the type, as you'll see, 50 to 75% penetrance, whereas Huntington's disease is, you know, virtually 100% penetrant, and there can be very variable expressivity of these things. So, as we all know, there's adenine and thymine and guanosine and cytosine, and those are the base pairs that pair up. And when they get messed up or deleted or added, you can have a sentence, which is what these make. These nucleotides actually make up sentences that code for different proteins, as you know. So if you have a sentence that says bake a cake and it gets changed to make a cake, then maybe it actually hasn't changed the function of that protein enough for it to matter. But if it changes to bake a lake, it probably doesn't function that well anymore. Okay, and that's just a layman's example of how it works. In addition, there's this whole issue in genetics of variants of uncertain significance. There's a lot of uncertainty in medicine, and in genetics there's even more uncertainty, okay? It depends on your index of suspicion. This is something that I can't stress enough. In most cases, the phenotype trumps genotype, okay? So if we're not proselytizing here for genetic testing to be global, okay? You have to have a reason to do it. If somebody has a high arched palate and their lenses are disconnected and they're tall and lanky and they look like Abraham Lincoln and their aorta is enlarged, they probably have Marfan syndrome. So if their genetic test comes back negative, it doesn't mean they don't have Marfan syndrome. If their genetic test comes back positive, we'll talk about how that's helpful, okay? There are other genetic tests that we do for long QT, for catecholaminergic polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, familial cardiomyopathy, et cetera. Okay, so there's a whole process. When you order a genetic test, and this is how simple it is, and I can talk to some of you later about it. There are major vendors that do this. We've settled on major vendors and have cleared it. We're probably just going to be a screening clinic. You really have to have access to a geneticist and genetic counselors to do this properly, but outreach clinics can screen many people, and we actually have a good working relationship with Memorial, who's also here tonight and has a geneticist and genetic counselors who are going to refer back to. So basically, there's a kit, and we don't even draw blood for this. There's a kit that comes with a bottle of Scope mouthwash in it. You don't have the patient eat for about 30 minutes beforehand. They swish and spit 3 times into a tube, which you mail to the genetics company, okay? They process the genes from there, and we'll talk about the different panels and so on. So it's actually pretty simple, believe me, the rep would love to come to the Cayman Islands to explain it to you. So when it gets analyzed, there are teams of people. These companies all take their business very seriously, and they realize that they have to fill gaps, and that not every place that's going to be using this is going to be a university center with even a good genetics department, okay? So basically, when you send something to them, it is reviewed. They look to see what the literature shows. There are geneticists who are PhDs, there are MDs who are geneticists, and there are genetic counselors who review the findings of your study before it gets back to you and your patient, okay? They do a clinical review to see whether it's currently thought to be pertinent or not pertinent, and then they report it to you, and the report is about a 5-page report. You'll see there'll be a genetic defect on the front of the report, and they'll give you a whole literature review point by point, which is a big, you know, you can read it if you want, but on the bottom line is on the back page, they'll tell you whether it's important or not and why, and their genetic counselors and geneticists are available to you by phone, okay? So this is the latest terminology that they use since 2015, that a mutation is either a pathologic variant, it is a likely pathologic variant, a variant of uncertain significance, as we've talked about, a likely benign variant, or a benign variant. And that's the spectrum that we sort of go on here. So if something is positive and it's a known pathologic variant, it's diagnostic and actionable. And this is the way the report will come back to you, too. So those who test, and you want to have what's called the proband, the person that you think has the disease. This becomes important in sudden death patients because we're now in the process of trying to educate our pathologists that they need to preserve tissue in a different way. They need to freeze tissue and freeze blood from victims of sudden death so that it can be tested later because there are all kinds of scenarios that can happen. Otherwise, if you're not really dealing with the proband, the person who you thought had the disease, then you really don't know if that's what caused the genetic problem. So if they test positive, they're at risk of developing the disease. Then you want to test other family members and see if they have that same variant. If they have that same variant, then they're at risk of developing the disease too. But as we'll see, there's variable penetrance to different things too. So if they have a likely pathologic variant, we would consider that also diagnostic and actionable in the same way, except those who were test positive are very likely of developing the disease, and those that test negative may still be at risk. And that's the important thing. If a family member doesn't have the same pathologic variant as their sibling or their mother or their father, then they're probably safe. A negative result, likewise, doesn't alter the patient's diagnosis. As I said with my example with Marfan syndrome, if you think they have Marfan syndrome, they have Marfan syndrome. It's not 100%, and we don't know all the variants. And it's interesting because I guess atrial fibrillation is the most common arrhythmia we deal with nowadays, and everybody's trying to figure out from a genetic point of view if there's a propensity for atrial fibrillation. And we think that there probably is, as we do see it in families, but right now there are too many genes associated with it to make any logical conclusions. And then there's our old VUS, variant of uncertain significance. It's not diagnostic and it's not actionable. But here's what these companies do. They keep track of all of this information for the life of the patient. And if something changes and moves this that way or that way, they update you on it, okay? So, as I said, they are really doing a great job as far as I'm concerned. The problem is that there's also de novo variants that can happen, and there are things that that are reduced in terms of penetrance. Okay, so something like LV non-compaction, which we'll see a picture of but won't go into, probably has about a 60 to 80% of a spontaneous variant occurring. So that's not something that you're going to be able to pick up on a genetic test very easily, whereas something like hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy is very penetrant and autosomal dominant, and you probably will be able to pick that up and go along with things from a genetic point of view, and that becomes important for the patient. Okay, so we do, as I said, proband testing, and then when you test the brothers and sisters and kids and grandkids and maybe even backward to the parents in some cases, that's called cascade testing. And that's the most helpful thing that you can do with genetic tests. So who do you want to test? The most important thing, as I said, is the phenotype, because if somebody really doesn't have any phenotype at all, any expression at all, and you're just shotgunning it, well, the noise in the genetic test gets to be so bad that it's probably not worthwhile doing, and you're just going to muddy the waters, okay? You can Google anything these days, and Google Scholar actually has gene reviews on it. And if you wanted to go beyond that little 5-page report that I told you and look up your own patient's gene variant, you can do it on gene reviews, and it'll give you a quick update on whatever is going on with that gene variant. Okay, so as I tell the interns and residents who we teach in internal medicine, if you have to ever guess anything in terms of cardiology, in terms of genetics, guess autosomal dominant. You'll be right greater than 80% of the time, okay? There are variants and whatnot, but most cardiac conditions are inherited as an autosomal dominant. The problem is that there's genetic heterogeneity, meaning that you can have multiple genes giving you the same phenotype, okay? Even to even make things more confusing, there's pleiotropy, which is the same genetic variant causing different phenotypes. So now it really gets to be crazy. There can be reduced penetrance in some people, and there's always variable expressivity. And we'll talk about that when it comes to specific conditions. So there are a number of things when you're dealing with cardiac patients that are red flags that you want to know about. Any sudden death in the family, any onset of age, obviously early onset ages of sudden death or ICD or pacemaker placement or heart failure. But there are other things too. For instance now, and you'll see that later, even SIDS deaths, sudden infant death syndrome, a certain percentage of sudden infant death syndrome are probably cardiac. They think maybe as much as 20%. So, you know, the baby's blood should probably be preserved and tested. Family history, obviously muscle weakness is more for the muscular dystrophies and also what they would call mitochondrial diseases. We all know about not only Marfan syndrome, but Turner and Noonan syndrome and so on and so forth. Those are obvious things and things that pediatricians really should be picking up to begin with. Sudden death or ICD less than age 50, heart failure less than age 60, exercise intolerance, early heart attacks, this is for homozygous or heterozygous hypercholesterolemia, aneurysms or dissections, but even things such as drowning or single car accidents. I mean, I think we're beginning to realize now that when people pass out, greater than 90%+ of the time it's cardiac, it's not neurologic. It's probably cardiac triggered, okay? So these are the main cardiomyopathies we're going to talk about. This is arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, which actually, long QT syndrome is also called a channelopathy. It's a problem with the sodium channel. Arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy is also a channelopathy. It overlaps. This is LV non-compaction, which you'll see, which, as I said, has mostly a spontaneous variant, so we're not going to talk much about that, where you see the muscle fibers are not very organized. This, of course, is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, and restrictive cardiomyopathy. Okay, restrictive is really something that is also picked up in children and is a childhood disease, so we're not going to be talking about that. And that's for them again. So as you can see, I'm sorry this didn't reproduce very well, but there are multiple gene panels that you screen for, whether you think it's hypertrophic. So none of this is rocket science, right? You think somebody has hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you check the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy panel. You think they have dilated cardiomyopathy, 61 genes, that's a lot of genes. What we don't want people to do is check the whole cardiomyopathy panel, which is 120 genes. That kind of mucks things up a bit. And this is the overlap. And again, this did not reproduce very well, but these are all the genes, and with the Venn diagrams, you can see that there's a fair amount of overlap with these different genes and variants. So cardiomyopathies in general have an overall 30 to 50% yield with genetic testing. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, 40 to 60%, although there are certain variants that are higher. Familial cardiomyopathies, 35 to 40%, and arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, 35 or 40%. So with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, this is 1 in 500 people. It's highly penetrant, as I said. It's the most common structural cause of cardiac sudden death and the most common cause of sudden death in young athletes. The severity of the disease depends on the age of onset. With a lot of these things, including long QT syndrome, Brugada syndrome, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you'll see a lot of the sudden death people draw a line at the age of 40. If I'm diagnosing this in somebody after the age of 40, they probably don't have as malignant a variant of the condition because they would have had an event long before this. So that's something else that you can keep in mind. So hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, we all know, has thick walls. It could be obstructive. Although I like this picture because, as you'll see, this is called the reverse septal view. And this variant here, where you don't actually have the obstruction up here in the LV outflow tract, but you've got thickness in the wall down here, actually has a higher genetic propensity to be picked up, maybe as high as 80%, okay? These are diagnosed generally by EKG and echo, although I will tell you that probably the best test is cardiac MRI. There are certain predictors, as we all know, of sudden death in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, whether somebody's had a sudden death in the family, whether they've had a syncopal episode before, whether they have non-sustained ventricular tachycardia on a Holter monitor, whether they have hypotension with exercise. And then the last thing is how thick their septum is. Is it more than 3 millimeters? Well, I can tell you in my own practice, because of the limitations of echo in general and a patient's body habitus, I've had a couple of people that I thought were, you know, not as malignant a variant. And when we did cardiac MRIs on them, their septums were huge. I mean, I thought that they were less than 3 millimeters, and they were well over 3 centimeters. So they were at risk, and we didn't appreciate it by echo as much as by MRI. Not every place has MRI, unfortunately. And these are the proteins affected, the actin and myosin proteins for cardiomyopathy. And when you look at the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy under a microscope, as opposed to being those nice linear forms, you see that there's a mishmash of the way the myofibrils are set up. And these are the major genes associated with it and their frequency of occurring in the disease, okay? There can be 25 genes that occur that cause hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but these are the major ones, and that's generally what most of the genetic testing goes on. But as I said, the penetrance is variable. I mean, I've made new diagnoses of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in 60, 70, and 80-year-olds, okay? So the more malignant forms, people are going to have problems with syncope and unfortunately even sudden death in young athletes in their teens and in their 20s, as you know. But as I said, there are some people that can live into their 70s and 80s and have very little in terms of consequence with this disease. Obviously, they don't have the thick septums. They're not having, maybe they even weren't athletic as they were younger or growing up. Okay, so in terms of the genes and predicting things like sudden death, this MYH7 gene has a more severe form of the disease. This gene here probably is the one I was just talking about, where you pick it up in people 50s, 60s, 70s. And the important thing about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is that if you find it in a family member and you don't have genetic testing or a genetic marker, you're supposed to follow the kids and the grandkids and the siblings of that person for every 5 years with an echo, because there are a certain number of them that will start to develop the hypertrophy in their 30s and 40s and 50s, okay? And you'll see this again and again with all the other genetic testing that we do. People can have more than one genetic variant, and if they do, they have a more severe form of the disease, okay? This is the other reason to do genetic testing in hypertrophs. First of all, the American Heart Association, the American College of Cardiology are very progressive organizations, and we have guidelines for almost everything, as opposed to many of the other sub-branches of internal medicine as well as surgery. But they don't have anything for guiding us in terms of genetic testing. We go by the Heart Rhythm Society and the European Society of Cardiology. They give us most of our guidelines for genetic testing. And in Europe, it's not a problem because it's paid for and they want you to do genetic testing for the most part. In the United States, it's not. But a certain percentage of people tested, and this is always tested for hypertrophs, a certain percentage of people tested positive for, that were thought to have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy have actually Fabry's disease. Well, what's the importance of that? There's an enzyme treatment for that. It's an infusion every 2 weeks and you can help that condition. In addition, 9 to 12% will actually have amyloid, okay? So this is a point system, and as I said, when you talk about the reverse septal variant that I was pointing out on that picture, it has even a higher genetic yield of having a positive test. So all individuals with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy should be genetically tested, okay? And if they're positive, you have something to follow for their family. That's the important thing, okay? And if their family tests negative, then you don't have to screen them every 5 years for the rest of their life. So there's you know, important implications there for genetics and genetic testing. And now there's dilated cardiomyopathy, prevalence of about 1 in 2,500. It can be dilatation of one or both ventricles. 20 to 50% is familial, okay? I actually have a gentleman who came in who had no history of anything. His EKG was abnormal. We did an echo on him. He had an echo that showed an EF of about 35 or 40%. And he had a mother who died of congestive heart failure with no diagnosis known at an early age in life, no history of rheumatic heart disease. So we brought his son and two daughters in, and his son is about 25 years younger than him, had the same, the echoes looked identical. So you can either have an episode of sudden death, less than 35, and the dilated cardiomyopathy, or two people in the same family, and you can make that diagnosis, but you can also do the genetic testing. Now, unfortunately, because it's not 100%, these people don't have a genetic marker to follow, okay? So their kids and grandkids are at risk and still need to be followed. Again, it is autosomal dominant, although there are many different forms of it. 61 genes, this is the biggest nightmare in all of the testing that we do, can be associated with it. There are different genetic variants, and if you have more than one genetic variant, it's worse. And if you have conduction system disease with the dilated idiopathic cardiomyopathy, it's also portends a worse prognosis. 5% of more than two pathologic variants. It's also associated with all the muscular dystrophies. And here's something interesting. Women in particular, but everybody, women with peripartum cardiomyopathy should probably be tested because they probably have a familial, they may have a familial cardiomyopathy that then you can follow for the rest of the family and see if they're at risk. And as we know, this is a high risk of coming back again if they get pregnant again, okay? So again, for dilated cardiomyopathy, although the yield isn't as good as hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, it's a good test to do, and if they have a variant, it's something you can follow, and it's something you can help the family with, especially if they've had any kind of sudden death in the families. The next thing I'm going to go into are the channelopathies. Long QT syndrome, we're not going to do short QT, catecholaminergic, polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, Brugada, as we all know, and arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. This is the sodium channel. I'm sure you all knew that as soon as I put it up there, right? Okay, so, and as you can imagine, most of the genetic variants that are pathologic, remember I said it can be bake a cake or make a cake? Well, some of the variants, genetic variants in this region are like make a cake, okay? It's not bake a cake, but it probably doesn't change much. The genetic variants along here are bake a lake. It really changes things substantially in these patients. And these are all the genes and how they overlap for the different conditions. So as you can see, there's plenty actually of overlap. So in patients with long QT, there's a high genetic preponderance. In patients with CPVT, and in patients with arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. So long QT syndrome, here's a perfect example of it. It's about 1 in 2,000 to 5,000 variable age of onset. 10 to 40% of them may have normally corrected QTCs on their EKG, which becomes a nightmare. As you know, there's long QT1, long QT2, and long QT3, and that can be, those are the three major variants of it. They have a high risk of sudden death. There are about 17 genes associated with long QT syndrome, but 95% of those 17, out of 17 genes, 95% are these three genes, okay? So it's something that's easily testable. Long QT1, they tend to manifest their problems during exercise, long QT2 during sleep arousal or startling, and long QT3 during the resting state. And there can be more than one variant, and if there's more than one variant, as I said before, these people tend to do worse, okay? All people with long QT should be tested genetically for their family's sake because there's a significant component of sudden death. there's an interesting example. I went to a Mayo Clinic symposium on cardiogenetics, and this illustrates why it's important to know the person, the proband, the first case. There was a boy of about 10 years old that had sudden death, and the family, the mom had three other daughters and was worried about what the risk of another child dying was, you know, something very reasonable. So they went somewhere and got genetic tested, and the mom had what they thought was a variant that could be associated with long QT, but as I said, it wasn't one of the major three, it was one of those minor variant ones of the other 17, which we really don't know very much about. A defibrillator implanted in the mother, and all three daughters had the same variant, so they put defibrillators in all three daughters. Okay. Lo and behold, they went to the Mayo Clinic for a second opinion after this was all done, and they managed to get tissue from the proband, from the son that had died, and he didn't have the variant that they had, and they explanted all four defibrillators. Okay, so that's the minefield of genetic testing without, you know, knowing what you're doing and without getting proper backup and proper counseling and so on and so forth. There's Brugada syndrome, as we know. Brugada syndrome is also a minefield. Brugada type 1 is the only one that needs genetic testing. 2 and 3 don't really have much yield as far as that's concerned, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. So this is the general yield with CPVT. That should be tested. But CPVT is also predominantly a childhood disease where children exercise and they get ventricular tachycardia. So that's generally more of a childhood than an adult disease. Long QT, we talked about, has a high yield. Brugada, unless it's Brugada type 1, you're not going to do much about that. Okay, so thoracic aortic aneurysm and dissection, called TAD, and there's another one too. There's a lot of people in the United States that die of thoracic aortic aneurysm and or dissection, and 20% may have a genetic predisposition. This is what the Marfan's people would fall into. And the importance is that whereas there are criteria for operating on thoracic aortic aneurysms at about 55 millimeters or 5.5 centimeters, when it comes to Marfan syndrome or some of these other variants, you want to start operating and repairing their thoracic aortic aneurysms at 4 centimeters or even 4.5 centimeters. So it's important to know what you're dealing with. It's heterogeneous. There could be 20 genes associated with it. Marfans, we know, these are variants that we probably mistaked as Marfans for years, Louis Dietz and Spritz and Goldberg. They have an onset of early age. They may have very typical features. They may also have abdominal aortic aneurysms, cerebral aneurysms, popliteal aneurysms. They can also be associated with patent ductus arteriosus and bicuspid aortic valves. It's been well known for more than a decade now. If you have somebody, and by the way, this is the most common structural abnormality of the heart. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy may be the most common structural abnormality that leads to sudden death, but bicuspid aortic valve is the most common structural abnormality of the heart. And these people all need to be screened for an aortopathy, okay? They need to have a CAT scan with contrast or an MRI to make sure their aorta is normal, because they may have another disease on top of that, okay? So Marfan syndrome, as we know, can affect the ocular system, skeletal system, the cardiovascular system. It's usually this gene, FBN1, but as I said, there are many genes associated, but this is the gene that is most found. But 25% can be de novo, okay? There's also what's called the MAS syndrome, myopia, mitral valve prolapse, borderline non-progressive aortic root dilatation, skeletal findings, skin findings, etc. These are all kind of related to what we used to call, when I was training, funny-looking kid syndrome. And you all have seen that. So, again, if they don't have any symptoms or signs, you don't want to just send off genetic panels on them. But if they have some red flags, you do. And it's interesting because when you talk to geneticists, You can do everything online now. If you Google Marfan syndrome, there will be, you can bring up a page that will ask you questions about your patient, and it's a scoring system, and it will tell you if they scored above this amount, they're likely to have Marfan syndrome. If they scored below this amount, they're not likely to have Marfan syndrome. And it was interesting in talking to the pediatric geneticists that they often use these online tools, and some of them even have apps on their cell phones for these things to do these scoring systems over and over again. So this is the genetics for both of them combined. And as I said, you can have more than one. The Ehlers-Danlos type we all know is another one too. And as I said, the most important thing here is that you have to look for aneurysms in other areas, and you have to operate on these people early. But the clinical features can be variable and nonspecific. The phenotype and the genotype may differ considerably. The phenotype may change with age. In other words, people develop things, or hopefully you appreciate that. Even though it's genetic, it's not always there from birth. It can be manifest as people grow and get older, as kids grow and get older. That's also hopefully something you've gotten out at this point. There can be milder presentations that you can just follow and may not need more done about. The biggest thing here is, again, aortic dissection and rupture, as we know at young age. The mitral valve prolapse isn't a big thing. The patent ductus arteriosus should have been picked up at an early age. And the panel for that is 49 genes long, okay? Hyperlipidemia, this is our last topic, so hopefully I've been brief enough and held your interest enough, and then we'll have some time for some questions. Homozygous familial hypercholesterolemia, 1 in 1,000,000. And heterozygous familial hypercholesterolemia, much more common, 1 in 200 to 500. This is European data because I said they consider genetic testing compulsory. So what they're finding, and if you find this in the Netherlands and in Norway, what they're finding is that if you screen your population, you're going to find a whole bunch of people with heterozygous hypercholesterolemia that you didn't know about. And what's important about that is especially now, again, we tend in the United States, because they don't readily pay for genetic testing, to make the diagnosis clinically, an LDL, you know, greater than 190, depending on your age, greater than 220 or 250, total cholesterol 350 to 500, you can generally make the diagnosis of plus or minus premature atherosclerosis in one first degree relative. You can usually make the diagnosis with good certainty as to homozygous or heterozygous hypercholesterolemia. We all know that it leads to men to have 50% will have an event before 50, 30% of women before 60. We all know about the xanthelasma and the arcus senilis, corneal arcus there. And as I said, there's also an autosomal recessive type, but most of them are the autosomal dominant type. Now, we all knew about LDL receptors, and we all knew about apoprotein B, which houses most of the atherogenic particles. We've all now heard of PCSK9, okay? You know, interesting story in and of itself, and actually a pretty good story in terms of how it was developed. There were a number of, there was a small black community that had no evidence of atherosclerosis, and they were wondering why, despite their, and had very low LDL cholesterols, and what they found was they had a variant of this protein. What this is, it's a protein that's produced by the liver that is endocytized by the LDL receptor, and when the LDL receptor and the cholesterol go into the liver, it tells the LDL receptor to be destroyed, and new LDL receptors are made. So they developed a blocking antibody for this protein, and this antibody blocks this protein so it doesn't bind to the LDL receptors. So the LDL receptors hang out 2 to 3 times longer. So there's more LDL receptors grabbing the cholesterol all the time, and the LDL level goes down. And this produces dramatic decreases in the cholesterol, as much as 50, 60, sometimes 70%. It's an injectable subcutaneously twice a month generally, although I have some people that are on it just once a month because they had such a great response. And until recently, as we were talking earlier, there was no data at all. We were hoping, when I put people on this drug, I said, look, you know, if you can't be on a statin, statins are the drugs of choice because they have great data over 40 years showing benefit, decreased heart attack, decreased strokes, etc. We did not have that data despite the dramatic decrease in cholesterol with PCSK9 inhibitors. But at the most recent ACC meetings, American College of Cardiology meetings, there's actually brand new data that shows that these drugs do benefit. We hoped that they would benefit, but we had no proof, and that's what I used to tell people. So what's really interesting about this story, too, is that the homozygous hypercholesterolemics really probably aren't homozygous. They don't have two genes with a defective LDL receptor. They have two alleles, I should say, with a defective LDL receptor. What they actually have is they have a problem with their LDL receptor and one of these two, ApoB or PCSK9 combined. That's what causes their severe hyper. These are the people that have cholesterols of 500, 550 with LDLs that are over 300. Okay? So that's an interesting story there. So again, there's a recommendation from the Heart Rhythm Society and the and the European Cardiology Society to do genetic testing. This, as I said, in the United States, there is no mandatory policy, but it's very interesting now because when I try and get patients PCSK9 inhibitors, I get a denial immediately, and I get something from the drug company that says, do they have genetically documented homo or heterozygous hypercholesterolemia? So it becomes a catch-22. So when you get your kit that they swish and spit into the cup, and you put their name on the panel, you check off one of these panels here for whether you think, if you know that you're looking for arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia or a long QT syndrome or Marfan's, or familial cardiomyopathy, you just check off one of those panels and they'll run all those genes for you. If you have a genetic variant, then that's all you test for. Once you have a genetic variant proven for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and you want to do proband and you want to do cascade testing for the rest of the family, you just test for that one gene. Okay, you don't test the whole panel anymore, especially since that's been proven. I'm going to skip that. All right, so why test? In some cases, as I said, none of them are 100%, but in some cases it removes the uncertainty about the cause of the phenotype. It allows cascade testing, and that may save lives. Cascade testing may save lives. It provides an option for prenatal diagnosis and pregnancy management. That's a little advanced. I haven't seen anybody really doing much of that. It'll save life of the family member and provide information that may help for other trial testing. What are the limitations? Not all patients are found to have a causative mutation. Even when you know and you try and do what's called whole genome sequencing, as you know, you can send your blood away and get your whole genome sequence, and they'll tell you what part Scandinavian you are and what part North American you are and what part African you are and so on and so forth. But even when you do whole genome testing in some of these people, you can't pick up any pathologic variants. The targeted panels are good enough for the most part. And unfortunately, these variants of unknown significance are never going to go away. What's the positive impact for affected adults? Increased confidence in the diagnosis, relief for the unaffected relatives, certainly that. Understanding compliance with screening, maybe it helps with compliance with screening. The negative impact may lead to skepticism or uncertainty about variants of unknown significance or anxiety or guilt with passing these things on. In the unaffected at risk, you can alleviate the uncertainty, provides time to adjust to the potential diagnosis, provides relief for those who are genotype negative, certainly. And again, the negative impact is the anxiety and distress and worrying about your children, which we all would do. So that's all I wanted to talk about at this point. Thank you for your attention.
And our second speaker comes to us from Cleveland Clinic, Florida, and his name is Dr. Robert Cuberu. He's going to be speaking about interventional therapies for stroke prevention. So Dr. Cuberu actually went to the same medical school as I did, so we know each other for a long time, Universidad Central de Venezuela. He then went on to do his residency at Mount Sinai Medical Center in internal medicine, then his fellowship at Mount Sinai as well for cardiology. He did a fellowship in Mass General Harvard Medical School for interventional cardiology, followed by one in the same place for structural heart disease. He holds certifications in cardiovascular disease, interventional cardiology, echocardiography, and nuclear cardiology. His special interest is structural and adult congenital heart disease. And we would like a warm welcome to Dr. Cuberu, please.
Okay, good evening. Thank you, Dr. Behera, and the Cayman Heart Fund for this terrific invitation and wonderful symposium. It's great to be here on behalf of the Cleveland Clinic in Florida. And I've been asked today to talk to you about some of the new and exciting evolving therapies for stroke prevention. Believe it or not, although you would think this would fall in the hands of the neurologist, as cardiologists, we've become increasingly involved with some of the stroke therapies that are currently available. So hopefully I can walk you through this lecture, keep you awake, and I hope you can learn something from this. So a bit of the cardiologist perspective. So let us review a little bit about stroke. Stroke is certainly a very important condition. Just to remind ourselves, it is the third leading cause of death, the first leading cause of serious disability, and it affects an overwhelming number of patients. We see it every day in our emergency rooms, and I'm sure you too can relate to the prevalence of this condition. Certainly associated with increasing costs, in part due to the disability involved, the multiple medications these patients take, and some of them end up in rehabs and so on for a long period of time. So one of the biggest players in stroke is atrial fibrillation, and I'm sure you all are aware of that. And as we age, the prevalence of atrial fibrillation increases, and we all know that atrial fibrillation carries an increased risk. Patients with AFib carry an increased risk of stroke. Most common arrhythmia, high morbidity and mortality, 10 to 20% of strokes are actually related to atrial fibrillation. Higher stroke risk for older patients and those with prior history of stroke. And strokes related to AFib actually are very scary, and they actually are associated with bad outcomes when you compare it to perhaps strokes related to carotid disease. They tend to be big clots that end up in your brain and cause disabling stroke. Now, we've learned, sorry about this slide, let me go back and see if it helps. We've learned in looking at the etiology of non-valvular atrial fibrillation that the great majority of the clots develop in a small little sac in the heart called the left atrial appendage. And you see this small structure that harbors clots frequently in patients with atrial fibrillation. Over 90 to 95% of the times, that's where clots develop. Now, how do we prevent clots from developing in this small structure? Well, we give patients, invariably, the most of them, anticoagulant therapy. And the one we've been using the most for over, or the ones we have the most experience has been certainly the use of warfarin. It has been the gold standard for the treatment of AFib stroke prevention, with 60 to 70% stroke risk reduction when compared to no treatment, and certainly favorable results over aspirin. So anticoagulant therapy is the gold standard for stroke risk reduction in patients with atrial fibrillation. Now, the reality is, and we can all relate to this, warfarin is not a good therapy. A lot of patients are either undertreated or overtreated, and with that, you get elevations in INRs or lower levels in INRs, and maintaining therapeutic range becomes a problem. This chart clearly demonstrates that only 50, 48, 60% of those patients are appropriately treated. So a lot of these patients are outside the therapeutic range. And when you look at the facts, 44% of bleeding events occur in patients who have therapeutic ranges above 3, 48% of embolic events occur in patients with therapeutic range below 2. So it's a problem. And it's a problem that carries a bad prognosis if you have a bleeding event, of course, or an embolic event. We've all seen the intracranial hemorrhage. And this is taken directly from press. Anticoagulant tops the list of emergency visits for adverse drug events in America. So we're responsible as cardiologists and physicians when we're putting a patient on an anticoagulant. It is our task to risk stratify that patient, to explain to that patient that they're going to be on an anticoagulant and potentially, certainly review the potential risks involved with this therapy. So we have different tools and we use them regularly, and I invite you to visit the web and use them in your decision making when you're taking care of patients with atrial fibrillation. There's a score called the CHADS-VAS score, and this is a score that's certainly recommended by the guidelines to determine the risk of stroke in a patient with atrial fibrillation. It turns out that if you have atrial fibrillation and you have hypertension, or your age greater than 75, or you're a female, or if you have congestive heart failure, your risk of having a stroke from atrial fibrillation increases importantly. And on the other hand, we have risk calculators to determine your risk of bleeding if you're taking a blood thinner or if you're going to go on a blood thinner. So we try to risk adjust these patients and determine whether they're good candidates for anticoagulation or not. Now, it's the warfarin paradox is as the CHADS-VAS score increases, you would expect more patients to be on anticoagulants. It turns out when you look at Medicare data from 2006 and 2007, the number of patients treated despite having greater risk of stroke with atrial fibrillation is actually lower. So if you look at this, you can extrapolate about 50% of those patients with high CHADS scores are unprotected, untreated, and at risk for a disabling stroke. And part of that is related to the narrow therapeutic window, patient refusal, risk of bleeding, drug interaction related to the use of warfarin. Now, with the introduction of the new therapies, Pradaxa, Xarelto, Eliquis, you would expect this number to rise. But when you look at this chart, it seems that with the introduction of NOACs, you get a minor decrease in the total use of warfarin, a minor increase in the total use of NOACs. But when you look at the totality, you still see that there's a good large number of patients that are untreated. And part of that is because there's high discontinuation rates with the new oral anticoagulants still. And adverse events are still there, 2 to 3% risk of bleeding. So there's been an unmet need for stroke risk reduction for patients with atrial fibrillation who are seeking an alternative therapy to oral anticoagulants. And for long, we've been testing the hypothesis that, well, if clots develop in this small little sac in the heart that's, for the most part, useless, other than harboring clots, can we prevent a stroke if we close this small sac and get patients off anticoagulants? A very simple hypothesis, one that was tested and has been tested for the past decade. And so if you type on PubMed, left atrial appendage closure and stroke, you come up with 366 papers published on this subject. It's been extensively evaluated. We have now multiple randomized clinical trials looking at this hypothesis. And of course, if I'm talking about it, it's because the results have been pretty good. And among these, you see all sorts of different plugs and devices and therapies looking at reducing the risk of stroke in patients with atrial fibrillation by closing the left atrial appendage. Now, among these, the only one that's really made it to market, at least until now, has been the Watchman occluder. So it's taken the name the Watchman procedure. The Watchman occluder is a small plug that is positioned in the left atrial appendage to close it, to seal it, and to prevent thrombus from developing within, and therefore reducing the risk of stroke. This is basically a list of all studies that have tested the Watchman procedure. The ones highlighted in yellow are the randomized clinical trials, the ones that the FDA approved. And these are the studies that literally took this therapy to market. The PROTECT-AF trial, just to quickly review, is a randomized clinical trial over 800 patients. And the study was designed to compare warfarin versus Watchman. And it was interesting, over 5-year data now, we see that the curves are pretty much superimposed. It tells us that the risk of stroke in the overall event rates of stroke, cardiovascular death, or systemic embolizations were pretty similar, non-inferior to warfarin. So a very important finding in the medical literature. If you look at a JAMA paper looking at this at 4 years and looking at some of the results of PROTECT, not surprisingly, the risk of hemorrhagic stroke was increasingly higher among the warfarin group as opposed to the watchman group. These patients were kept on therapy for 5 years, and that was a problem. And the other important finding and interesting finding is that there was an important mortality difference in favor of watchmen. So more patients, more deaths in the warfarin group. So another important finding in this head-to-head trial. The predicted ischemic stroke rates when compared to watchmen, this is computed versus watchmen, you see a marked reduction in stroke risk by plugging the left atrial appendage. This is an important landmark trial that was recently published and basically shows us what happens after watchman implant. And you compare the two groups, watchman events and warfarin events, and not surprisingly, you get a relative risk reduction of 71% on major bleeding complications from the use of warfarin. We now have meta-analysis looking at the same data and pretty much supporting what the randomized clinical trials have shown. Certainly higher incidence of hemorrhagic strokes in the warfarin group compared to the watchman group. And this final slide showing a cardiovascular unexplained death in favor of watchman when compared to warfarin. So very important findings, and the conclusion of this large meta-analysis from 2015 basically says in non-valvular atrial fibrillation, left atrial appendage closure decreased the risk of hemorrhagic stroke, cardiovascular death, and non-procedural bleeding when compared to warfarin. Well, this leads us to why the FDA has approved this therapy. The Watchman device is the first FDA-approved left atrial appendage closure device for the risk reduction of stroke risk in patients with non-valvular atrial fibrillation, and these are the recommendations taken strictly and straight from the FDA. Patients with atrial fibrillation who are at increased risk of stroke and have appropriate rationale to seek a non-pharmacological alternative to warfarin. This is what the Watchman device looks like. It's a nitinol frame, and they come in different sizes depending on the size of the appendage. So we tailor fit it to the LA appendage. The procedure is done in the cardiac cath lab suite, typically under general anesthesia because we require a transesophageal echo probe during the procedure. But I will say it's nothing much different than a catheterization in that we bring a catheter up from the femoral vein across the interatrial septum and then plug the left atrial appendage to close it shut. The procedure usually lasts an hour and a half. Complication rates are rather low and patients are typically discharged the following day. So this is the classic example, just to give you a feel of the kind of patients we're treating. 77, and this is a gentleman we did about 6 months ago. 77-year-old male with history of paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, hypertension, prior history of TIA, congestive heart failure, diastolic congestive heart failure, and who was referred with history of recurrent GI bleed on anticoagulant therapy. So we closed him back last year, and here's a picture, an example of what that procedure looks like. It's a transseptal puncture, and here's the device positioned in the left atrial appendage. We usually obtain a transesophageal echo 45 days after the procedure to review and examine the plug, make sure it's still in place, that the plug is endothelialized, and that there's no leaking around the plug and that the appendage is shut sealed. At that point, we then take patients off Coumadin, and we keep them on aspirin and Plavix for a few months, and then aspirin indefinitely. So these patients come back a few months later, very happy, and finally off their anticoagulants, and presumably protected moving forward with improved long-term cardiovascular events, as the literature would suggest. These are fluoroscopic views. This is what the appendage looks like when you inject in it with contrast. Here's what the plug looks like under fluoroscopy. And these are still frame images of the TEE, a very important tool in the cath lab, with 3D imaging to assess the Watchman device and the Watchman plug. So in the armamentarium of how we manage and treat patients with atrial fibrillation, aside from treating the rhythm, which is separate and aside, we use antiarrhythmics and so forth for that, we have to manage the stroke risk in these patients. And aside from warfarin and the newer oral anticoagulants, I think we can add to this algorithm the introduction of a novel therapy to close the left atrial appendage and to give a large number of these patients who are left unprotected, who for some reason or another are not good candidates for anticoagulation, the opportunity to live safely without an event long term. So, shifting gears a little bit, aside from cardioembolism from WATCHMAN, and I can take some questions and we could talk a little bit about it later, we can talk about another important stroke-mediated condition, which is the patent foramen ovale. Now, PFO is an interesting structure. If you look at the literature, there are so many things related to it, and perhaps in this room there are probably 20 or 30 of us that may have a PFO. This is pretty much a normal structure. A lot of us, a lot of the normal healthy individuals will have a PFO, which is a small communication between the intraatrial septum that naturally closes in many of us soon after birth. But in a few of us, it remains open, and that's about 15-20% of the population. But if you look at the literature, you'll find stroke related to PFO, platypnea orthodioxia, decompression illness, obstructive sleep apnea, and migraine headaches. But today we're going to talk about stroke and its relationship to PFO. Again, PubMed research, 2017, over 2,000 papers looking at PFO and its relationship to many comorbid conditions. This is what the PFO looks like. It's a small communication, a small flap, very different behavior from an atrial septal defect. We must not confuse the two. But this flap creates a windsock effect that allows blood to shunt from the right side of the heart to the left side of the heart. In fact, it's a very important structure during fetal development. It guarantees appropriate circulation through the heart and the left heart and allows the placental blood to be pumped adequately through the systemic circulation in the fetus. Again, naturally, this is supposed to close, but in a good number of patients, it doesn't. The mechanism postulated is the formation of clot either within the tunnel or in the deep pelvic veins or the lower extremities, of course in the venous side, travels up to the right side and then translocates through the PFO to the left side, which we all know should be the clean, deoxygenated blood, and then from there it ends up in your brain. So this is the postulated mechanism. And we know that there is a relationship between the two. The problem is identifying when a PFO is the culprit. When is it an incidental finding, and when is the PFO really causing the stroke in a given patient? But we know that the pathophysiology is there. Here is a clear image showing a clot in transit. These are pathology specimens showing clots straddling through the foramen ovale. If these dislodge, they'll end up in your brain. So how did the theory begin? How did it start? How did we get to this this hypothesis? Well, if you look at the prevalence of PFO in normal victims, in normal subjects like perhaps ourselves, you find that 10, 24%, 18%, up to 25% of patients will have a PFO. But when you look at patients that present with stroke of unknown origin, it turns out that up to 50 to 56% of those patients actually have a PFO. So that's when we begin to think that there's maybe a relationship in those patients. This is a paper published in the New England showing that not only in young victims, but even in victims age 55 or greater, you need to think about the possibility of a PFO-mediated event. And this is not anything new. This was first described by a pathologist in the 1800s who said, a German pathologist describes the case of a fatal cerebral aneurysm, embolism that he believed had passed through a PFO. Now, the problem is we don't think about this condition. And more often than not, patients come to the hospital, they get a standard echo, a standard Holter, a standard carotid ultrasound, and then they're discharged. But we forget to order an echo bubble study at rest and Valsalva. And if you don't order this test, which is very simple, it's agitated saline, everyone has saline, you will not make the diagnosis. You can't pick it up on color flow Doppler. So what does that look like? Well, normally when you inject agitated saline, as you're acquiring the echo images, you should only see bubbles in the right side of your heart. You should not see bubbles on the left side of the heart. But if you do see bubbles on the left side of the heart, as shown here in this still frame image, then you should suspect that there's some type of cardiac communication and perhaps a PFO condition that could have caused a stroke in that patient. Once we see a positive bubble study, we typically order a transesophageal echo to confirm the anatomy and to establish the diagnosis of a PFO. And it's very important as clinicians, at least us specialized in this field, to look at the anatomy, to understand the septum. What's the size of the defect? What's the size of the tunnel? Is this truly incidental, or did someone really sneak through this hole? And we look at other anatomical conditions that really allow us to risk stratify and determine whether that patient has really had an event or not. We also look at clinical variables. It's not the same to see a PFO in a 90-year-old than on a 50-year-old who's come in with a stroke. The 90-year-old has lived with it for 90 years. Chances are the PFO is not necessarily the cause. And we look at other comorbidities. Is this patient free of any other condition, or is he hypertensive, diabetic? Does he have other reasons to have a stroke other than foramen ovale? Hypercoagulable results, MRIs, carotid ultrasounds. We take all these variables into account. In fact, we ask a lot about migraines, and it's interesting because there is a very close relationship between migraines and PFO. In fact, I have a series of patients that I've closed their PFO because of a stroke that have suffered migraines and they never saw a migraine again after the PFO was closed. The problem is that when you look at the migraine PFO studies, you don't necessarily find positive results because you're throwing in there a large bucket of patients that may get migraines from caffeine or chocolate or many other mechanisms. But when you look at a stroke victim that has a large PFO and you think that's the cause and they too have migraines, you better be sure that there's an 80% chance or more that you're going to be getting rid of those migraine headaches that perhaps are mediated, we believe, by microembolisms and other postulated hypotheses. But anyways, so what's the treatment? So now we have a 55 or 68-year-old gentleman who comes in with a cryptogenic stroke of unknown source. You know that he has a large PFO or a reasonable size one. What do we do for those patients? For many years, we've been debating, should we close these defects? Should we treat them medically? And I won't bore you to death, but there's a ton of literature out there, and I'm going to try to summarize it for you. The reality is, does warfarin really work? Because there are those that advocate for blood thinners. Half of the patients, again, don't receive it or don't take it, and it's a therapy you're going to give to someone who's 50 years old for the rest of his life. You got to take that into account. 2-3% major bleeding complications per year, 18% minor bleeding episodes per year. Warfarin's associated with intracranial hemorrhage. There's no real good warfarin versus placebo trial. And some people say, well, maybe aspirin is enough. Well, if you ask a hematologist the role of aspirin in vein thromboembolism, they're not very excited with the pathophysiology and the potential role of it. In any case, there have been a multitude of studies. This is PFO closure versus medical therapy. These are all comparative studies looking at the two, suggesting that perhaps closure is better than medical therapy long term. The reality is there have been many limitations and restrictions with these trials. Part of it has been due to different types of occluders, different types of medication regimens, prolonged enrollment periods, poor patient selection. They're enrolling patients with small PFOs or perhaps an older patient that in which the PFO was simply incidental. But the one trial we want to remember and recently published now, we have 5-year data, is the RESPECT trial. And this is the trial that has led to FDA approval. In this study, they compared a PFO closure versus medical therapy, a well-designed trial with 5-year follow-up, patients age 60 or less with presumed paradoxical embolism and cryptogenic stroke. In this study, this Kaplan-Meier curve basically clearly illustrates a 54% relative risk reduction in the intention to treat population when compared to medical therapy long term, and 70% relative risk reduction in the recurrent events of cryptogenic stroke in the device arm when compared to those non-implanted. Furthermore, the study showed no intraprocedural strokes, no device embolization, no complication, thrombosis, or erosion. So the procedure is very safe. And nowadays, it's become rather simple to do. So the conclusion of the trial was that PFO closure is superior to medical therapy in reducing recurrent cryptogenic ischemic strokes. So as a consequence of this, and not too long ago, the FDA announced and approved this new device for the prevention of stroke risk reduction in certain patients in which the criterias and the conditions are met. So we have a comprehensive program at Cleveland Clinic that takes into account a multidisciplinary approach to the management of this condition between hematologists, neurologists, and we meet regularly to discuss these patients. And we determine based on the anatomy, their clinical condition, their comorbidities, we help those patients through the process and decide how best to treat them. Real quickly, just a few, 5 more minutes, this is how the procedure is performed. This is done under local anesthesia, small incision in the right femoral vein, and we deploy a device that looks typically like a double umbrella device across the intraatrial septum with hopes of closing this defect and preventing any future clots from traveling through the device. This is a cool case, and I'll show this case because I think it really highlights the involvement. And I know you're standing there because it's time. So, but you'll love this case, Bella. Pay attention. This is a 52-year-old Haitian woman that presented with recurrent TIAs. She had 2 events in 2 weeks. And it was the second time she had come to the hospital. The first time she was discharged with a diagnosis of cryptogenic stroke. They put her on aspirin, and 2 weeks later she came back to the ER. She had normal telemetry, normal sinus rhythm, normal carotids, normal hypercoagulable panel, but she did have an abnormal MRI. So they got a baseline echo finally with a bubble study the second time around, and they found that she had significant bubbles in the left side. At that point, they called me to do a TEE. And when I did the TEE, Lord and behold, we saw this huge clot straddling through the foramen ovale. I had never seen one this impactful. And as shown there, it looked like a little snake traveling through. So we didn't really know what to do. And at the same time, we noted that her pressures were a little high, that the right atrium and right ventricle were dilated. So my thought then was to get a CT scan to make sure she didn't throw a clot to her lungs as well. And so I did immediately after, and it turns out that she had saddle embolisms despite being entirely asymptomatic, sitting in both of her lungs with this clot straddling through the defect. Mind you, these were TIAs. She was entirely asymptomatic. So what did we do next? This was Friday, 10 a.m., after we got the CT, and we discussed different options. Do we extract the thrombus with a catheter and proceed with PFO closure? Do we give IV thrombolytics? Do we give heparin and put an IVC filter? Do we refer her for open surgical embolectomy and also embolectomy in her lungs? Or do we do none of the above? In any case, we called our friends, some of our colleague surgeons. This was several years ago. I wasn't at the Cleveland Clinic then. But the case was turned down by the surgeons. They felt that that was inappropriate. They didn't have any experience with embolectomies. And so we decided to admit the patient to the ICU and put her on heparin and put an IVC filter because she had showered embolism to her lungs. Mind you, her lower extremity Dopplers were negative. So we went ahead and put an IVC filter. This was Friday morning, and we left her in the unit under heparin, frequent neurochecks, strict bed rest, lots of laxatives to avoid Valsalva, no coughing, and lots of prayers. And we checked on her regularly. So Saturday, Sunday, Monday came around, and then Tuesday I'm scratching my head saying, where am I going with this? So the next day, 5 days later, I decided to do a TEE, and the clot wasn't there anymore. She was entirely asymptomatic. We don't know what happened to the clot. I doubt it had dissolved, but it probably went to the right place. But at that point, I said, let's book the case now. We're closing this. So I took her downstairs, and the first thing I did is I did an angiogram of the IVC filter. And what you see here is a huge clot that was trapped over the weekend. Do you see that snake trapped in there? And that had saved her life. Presumably, we learned later that it was coming from her deep pelvic veins, and this lady actually had a cold tumor. that we learned after the fact. So I couldn't go through the IVC filter, but we were proud to have saved her life, luckily. And so we tried a transjugular approach, and her venous axis was terrible. She had clots on both of her venous axes. So then we decided to do a trans-hepatic approach. This is just a fancy illustration. And again, just to give you a flavor of the things that we can do nowadays with catheter-based therapy, we see here a closure of the through the hepatics of the foramen ovale. And we really took it an extra step because this lady was clotting on over. She had had two events, and we were really worried about her. So with that, I'm going to finalize by saying that it is exciting times for interventional therapies, not only in the acute setting, but now we can add to stroke prevention, WATCHMAN, and PFO closure. I think a multidisciplinary team approach is important, the involvement of other specialties in the decision-making of these conditions. Thank you for your attention.
You're in the Cayman Islands, which is a world center for diving. So what's the relationship between PFO and decompression sickness?
Wonderful question. There is a close relationship in that we're always concerned of these microbubbles and these bends and these conditions that scuba divers get translocating through the foramen ovale and potentially causing harm in the systemic or arterial circulation. So there's nothing written clearly in the guidelines in the management, but if you're a professional scuba diver and you've had any similar events or bends of complications of that nature, or you're considering becoming a professional scuba diver, at our center, we actually do comprehensive evaluation. We actually have a physician that specializes in scuba divers and educates them and in their involvement. And we encourage them not to do it, not to perform scuba diving. And if they do, there is actually the indication for closure. So you could potentially close these defects in those that kind of live off of this and perform scuba diving, professionally. For those who do, once a year kind of thing and it's just recreational, we would advise you not to do it, or at least not to perform deep dives before we indicate closure in those cases.
Any other questions? I was wondering what the sensitivity is to the bubble study, the echocardiogram for finding PFOs.
Yes, excellent question. So the sensitivity and the yield and the cost is very low because it's just agitated saline. And the sensitivity is rather high. It's above 80%. But you want to do Valsalva. When you do Valsalva, you increase transiently the right atrial pressure, and then you put a little more force into that PFO flap and allow blood and allow to really identify the presence of right to left shunting. So Valsalva is an important point. If you don't get an echo bubble study with Valsalva, and that's a very simple technique. You ask the patient to bear down and then to breathe and so on, and then it really impacts it impacts the sensitivity of the test, and you'll be able to diagnose it.
Thanks for reminding me how much of a sucker for punishment I am. All right. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me out, and I also wanted to congratulate you all on the awesome turnout. It really shows how much people in Cayman care about the care of the patients and they're interested in hearing about innovative therapies. Show of hands, how many people in the room look after children? So there are a few of you. Unfortunately, I guarantee you that unlike the previous talks, you will use nothing that I tell you about today in your office. But it will actually highlight what your partner across the way is doing with innovative therapies and taking care of our kids that come in with very, very complex problems. So you know, there are two categories of kids that we look after. One is those that are born with a congenital heart defect, and then the other is kids that have really a structurally normal heart, but for whatever reason develop a cardiomyopathy. It might be viral, it might be because of non-compaction, it may be because of an arrhythmia. But whatever the cause, you can exchange the presentation of this kid for someone that actually has decreased myocardial function. And so the case that I'm going to present to you to highlight some of the innovative therapies that we're involved in is a 4-year-old, 20-kilogram male transferred to Joe DiMaggio Children's for evaluation and management of left ventricular dilation and dysfunction. He ultimately was diagnosed with non-compaction cardiomyopathy, and unfortunately, despite the fact that we really maximized medical therapy and did everything we could for this kid, he just didn't respond. And the decision was made to go to the OR for ventricular support device placement. And currently in South Florida, we're the only active program doing this type of treatment, because it really involves a massive team and taking on a lot of risk to look after these kids. It turns out that in the United States, there is only one approved support device, and that is the Berlin Heart X-Core ventricular assist device. It's an external device that is connected to the heart via cannulas that are exteriorized through the skin. So this ventricular assist device doesn't live inside the patient. There are big tubes that come out of the patient, and the pump actually lives outside of the patient. It requires bypass to implant it. The blood is driven by air that pumps a diaphragm and moves the blood along. For reasons that I'll go through in the rest of the talk, there's need to change that pump out quite frequently sometimes. And this is what it looks like. This is the baby underneath the drapes and the diaper here, and you can see the two tubes that are going through the skin. One is connected to the aorta and one is connected to the apex of the ventricle. The apical cannula sucks the blood out that is coming into the left ventricle. There's a valve here. It goes into the pumping chamber and returns via the aorta. There's a range of sizes of these devices so that we can support kids depending on, you know, whether they're a neonate or whether they're a teenager, and a host of cannulas that come along with that. And this diagram just shows you that we were able to do left heart support. This is that apical cannula draining into the pump, the one returning into the aorta. And for right-sided heart support, we drain from the atrial appendage and we return to the pulmonary artery. I'm going to spend just another second on this pump because it's important for understanding the rest of what I'm going to tell you about. The blood enters here. There is a unidirectional valve that doesn't allow blood to go backwards. This is the blood chamber. This is where the air pump is connected to drive the diaphragm in here, and there's another unidirectional valve. This is a lot of foreign surface for blood to come into contact with. And therefore, we need to anticoagulate these patients aggressively. When I say anticoagulated, I mean you pinprick one of these kids and they're going to bleed. They have to be really well anticoagulated. But usually after implant, we wait 24 to 48 hours for the post-surgical bleeding to resolve. We start multiple blood thinners to prevent that clot forming, and it takes a couple of weeks to get these kids therapeutic. Platelet inhibition, coagulation cascade inhibition, there's a lot of steps that have to be blocked so that they don't form clots. And it involves constant monitoring of their anticoagulation. And the reason we do that is demonstrated very well in these two photos. This is a clot sitting at one of the valve cusps at time of changeout. So you can imagine this thing can just break off and shoot into the brain. This other figure shows a much less formed clot, but still blood sticking to the surface of the diaphragm. So everything I tell you about is relatively new. You know, heart surgery has really only been around since the 1950s, and any of the stuff that we do these days has really been around since the 1970s in any significant volume. So we're still learning about everything we do. And the first trial of Berlin Heart was done in and published in 2013. And it showed that 33% of kids that undergo this implant will actually have a neurologic event. To me, that was pretty unacceptable. I mean, we're trying to save these children's lives. We're either waiting for the heart to recover or we're waiting for an organ donor so we can go ahead and proceed with transplant. But hey, while we're waiting, you're going to have a 30% risk of a stroke. It's pretty significant. We looked at our own data and we actually matched that. We showed that even in our institution, we had a 30% experience of neurologic dysfunction. And when we looked at the data a little more closely, we realized that most of those strokes were happening in the very early period post-implant while you're getting that anticoagulation up to speed and while you're getting things balanced out. Well, unfortunately, as I mentioned when I started the talk, there really is nothing else. This is what you've got. So we were really thinking about a way to come up with a strategy to decrease the incidence of stroke in these kids. So it turns out that there is another ventricular assist device that can support the heart function in kids, and it's called Centromag. This is a magnetically levitated pump. There is no chamber where the blood actually sits to get pumped out. It is essentially a fish tank pump with an impeller that's just spinning and moving the blood along. Unfortunately, the device is only FDA approved for 6 hours. As I mentioned, it's a magnetically levitated pump impeller and it has no contact, so there is nothing squeezing or doing anything else to the blood. There's a huge range of flow, so we can support kids of all sizes, and it can actually be run without heparin because there's so little contact of blood with the pump. And an idea that we had was, well, if we go ahead and proceed with the Berlin heart implant the way that we normally do it, by putting these cannulas in through the skin into the heart, and normally where we would connect the Berlin heart pump to these cannulas, we could connect the PediMag in the early post-operative period. This is what the motor looks like of that pump. And when we looked at it, we realized it was easy to do using standard equipment. You could leave the operating room without any heparin, no rush to heparinize the patient, provide the full range of flows, and it was very easy to convert to the FDA-approved device when we felt like the child was ready. So in the case that I presented to you, we went ahead and did just that. Before weaning off bypass, we connected to the Centromag pump, or the PediMag, depending on the size of the patient. It's just a different name for a different size of the pump. And we supported that patient for 2 weeks while achieving the anticoagulation profile. And despite some clot formation in the tubes, the patient had no neurologic event. And that was because we think it's continuous flow versus pulsatile flow. And so even if a clot formed and came off of the tubing, that the laminar flow would bypass the carotids. In this patient, we successfully transitioned to the Berlin heart pump at 2 weeks. And what was really striking was there was no Berlin pump changeouts required. We tend to do a lot of these pump changeouts at a cost of about $40,000 a pop. In that early period, because every time you see clot, you really have to get rid of it. And we learned a lot of lessons about it, but essentially we thought that this was a really handy-dandy way to try and decrease the stroke incidence in patients undergoing this type of support. I can tell you now that there was another institution that was doing the same strategy at the time that we were doing this, and it's now become a very popular strategy throughout the country. Some institutions are actually choosing to go against the FDA recommendations and use the PediMag all the way through until transplantation. But it is still off-label and requires a formal study, I think, before we can really offer this widely as sort of the initial option. Any questions about the Berlin heart and anything that I've told you about so far? No? Okay, I'll keep moving because again, this is more just to show you some of the new and innovative things that we're doing, not that it's a practical talk. Oh, I forgot to show you. These are two of our patients at a press release that have undergone this therapy. And, you know, this young girl here lived in the hospital for 14 months waiting for a heart. So it is really a major deal for these families. They were there in the hospital for over a year waiting for the right organ to come available. And I believe we transplanted this girl on a Thursday, and we were back in the operating room Friday night, and did this young fella, so they did a press release just that we did the back-to-back transplants. And it's really a great therapy. If anyone has any hesitation about doing transplantation in children, they thrive. The half-life is 20 years for the organ, so you'll usually make it into your 40s before you need another heart organ. So one surgery for the transplant and maybe one more as an adult. It's pretty good therapy. Okay, the next problem is something that's a little more complicated and I think insidious. You know, valvular problems in children are a real problem for us. you know, valvular heart disease remains a really difficult problem because these kids are going to grow. You know, so whatever valve you choose to put in them in their young age, it's not going to work for them for very long because they've got a lot of somatic growth to go through. And because nothing that we have right now has any growth potential, these kids usually end up getting multiple cardiac operations throughout their life. And as a heart surgeon, there's only one thing that really makes you nervous, and that's when you go in for a re-sternotomy on a 4-time, 5-time, 6-time, 7-time re-sternotomy. The risk of getting into the heart while you're sawing the sternum open is exponential. And so you really want to minimize the number of times you're getting back into someone's chest and keep that under 4. The risk is reasonable up to about the 4th time. Don't tell the adult surgeons that because they're scared out of their minds when they go back for a redo, but the PD guys are pretty comfortable opening a chest 4 or 5 times. and so for those of you that haven't seen a mechanical valve, this is what they look like. It's either titanium, metal, carbonite, some kind of material with a big bulky sewing ring, and they don't make them in sizes for children. They only make them in sizes for small adults. And as we all know, children are not small adults. And even when we look at a bioprosthetic valve, look how bulky these things are. There's these struts, these metallic struts. This is the pericardial tissue and the sewing ring again. There's just nothing that we can implant in a small child. Furthermore, when you implant these two types of valves, you really are disconnecting the valve from the ventricle. These are the papillary muscles here, and the valve is normally connected to these papillary muscles via chordae, just like you see here on the right side. And that mechanism is a really important mechanism when you've got a long life to live. You know, you need the apex of the ventricle to come up and join the valve, and that those caudal attachments are a critical part of function. And when you take it away in children, they're growing up without this important function, and the hearts tend to dilate and get baggy. So the literature that's looked at what happens when you do valve replacements is dismal. This is a 40-year experience from one of our colleagues, John Brown, and in this age group where the median age of the patient, I believe, was 8 years of age, so this is, we're not even talking about infants here, we're talking about like kids that are 8 years old. You really only have to look out 10 years and 30% have already required a valve replacement. And as you get out further, you know, there's about a 40% chance that you're going to need to get your valve replaced if you've got a mechanical valve, and if you've got a bioprosthetic valve, it's going to last 5 to 7 years in a kid, so you're undergoing many re-sternotomies. And if you look at neonates, kids that are, you know, newborns and in that first year of life, it's even worse. Around about 40% at 5 years are going to need a new valve, and about 20% are going to have had a stroke event because of the anticoagulation. So, you know, to summarize that point, options for mitral valve replacement in kids are very disappointing, and there's very little promise for commercial development. The companies don't want to invest millions of dollars into developing a valve for a very limited number of patients. This isn't a field like in adult surgery where we're replacing thousands of valves a year, so we're stuck. There's really nothing out there. And unfortunately, the tissue engineering with stem cells has been really disappointing. It just hasn't worked yet. So something that we became interested in is this extracellular matrix. It's an area that purports to provide an extracellular matrix scaffold for the development and creation of cardiac structures that we could use to repair cardiac defects. And the premise is that you take a biological material, you decellularize it, and you leave intact all these proteins and regulators. Cell adhesion, differentiation, the patient's own cells move into the matrix, and then you undergo smart remodeling so that the structure becomes the structure that it's supposed to be. So a valve, if you put in the extracellular matrix into a valvular position and you have cells that grow into that, is there potential for that structure to become an actual valve? Well, extracellular matrix is approved by the FDA for use in the heart. It is not approved for use as a valve. And we have been at the forefront of using this material for closing ASDs, VSDs, using as patch extensions. So we had a lot of experience with this material. And using a technique that was initially described by Dr. James Cox many years ago for the tricuspid valve, we came up with this idea that what if we were to make a valve out of this extracellular matrix material and put it in kids with no need for anticoagulation, where the ventricle could be attached to the valve and allow the heart function to develop in its normal fashion, and with, okay, as a bonus, any potential for growth. Wow, wouldn't that be amazing? But when we were thinking about how to make this valve, traditional designs are really bulky and complex to manufacture. I mean, those, you saw those things that I showed you. Those require a lot of technology, factories, people, and they're very expensive. So being Australian, we like to make our own stuff. And we decided that we would take this single sheet of material and manufacture it into a valve. And so what we came up with was to take the flat sheet of material and in the operating room when we cut the child's valve out, actually measure the size that it needs to be. So I don't care if it's 10 millimeters, 12 millimeters, 14 millimeters, I can take that dilator, which is this metallic structure right here, and wrap my material around it and make a valve that fits the size of the child. And a couple of moves, you know, you sew the tube together. We literally make this in the operating room, like while we're there with the patient. So we sew the tube, the sheet together. We fold it over at the top to make an annulus that we actually sew to the patient's annulus. And then we make this little cutout to allow blood to flow past the valve and not obstruct the aortic outflow tract. And then we actually attach the distal end of it to the ventricle, just like the native valve would be. So these little arms act as the chordae that allow that mitral ventricular interaction. And to finish off, you then just sew the annulus to whatever size the child's annulus was. And we've now reported this technique in a number of patients. We're currently reviewing our clinical experience, and we are super excited about the potential of this technology. I can't speak too early, but we've got good, clear evidence of growth of one of these valves in a kid that's had it for a long time. These are just a couple of the case reports that we've put out there. But I can tell you that we are currently funded by the American Heart Association for a study where we're taking these valves and putting them in a ventricular simulator, and where these valves actually sit in the lab and just pump for weeks, bathed in different stem cell solutions and different chemo attractants to try and increase the attraction of cells to move into the matrix and to start remodeling as a valve. And the goal is to not just make the valve out of a sheet of core matrix, but a core matrix patch that's been pre-treated with something that actually helps ingrowth of the body's natural cells to sort of invade it and make it grow. And that's really all I had to show you. Like I said, it's nothing that you're going to be doing in your offices, but I thought it was interesting, and hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Thanks.
Great. It's really a pleasure to be here. Again, fantastic turnout. Hopefully we can talk a little bit about that arterial disease, vascular peripheral arterial disease. So what you see here is our new Miami Cardiac and Vascular Institute, which actually was just opened officially last month. And hopefully we'll show a little bit about that and what we're doing there. We used to have BCVI, or Baptist Cardiac and Vascular Institute, and this is when we closed it down about 4 years ago to start the building process. And this is that building that I just showed you here. And what we did is all this area here got expanded and increased the institute by about two-thirds. And this is what that building looks like now. So really exciting times for us. And this is the nice entranceway. Now, what is PAD and what is peripheral arterial disease? I think it's important to understand it's a real serious disease. It's really when cholesterol and fat collects in the walls of our arteries, and that's really a natural process, right? When we're born, our arteries are probably as clean as they're going to be. And as we age, they harden. That's really what arterial sclerosis is, hardening of the arteries. Obviously, how much we deposit and how we deposit it is related to a lot of factors. So we've already heard from our first speaker in terms of the importance of genetics, but also in terms of what lifestyle changes we make, also add more as to how that disease is going to have that phenotype in our body. But peripheral arterial disease, or PAD, affects the quality of life in terms of making our walking and limiting our walking, but also increases the risk of heart attack, stroke, amputations, and death. And that's really what I'm going to talk a little bit about. So it's this little picture. It's kind of a pictorial, really showing what we talk about when we talk about obstructive vascular disease. So in that big umbrella of vascular disease, you have obstructive disease, and you may have aneurysmal disease. And we see that normal artery when we're born with that smooth internal kind of layer, and then we start developing plaque, and you can have plaque rupture, what we're showing here. And that's really what this limitation can cause in terms of obstructing flow. And when we talk about an acute syndrome, we can have actually plaque rupture. And that can occur in the heart, but it can also occur in pretty much any artery in our body. So really it's an unrecognized crisis, a very prevalent, very morbid, really a mortal disease. We looked at that it's extremely underdiagnosed and undertreated. In fact, I would say physicians themselves may not recognize what a peripheral arterial disease and how important it is to identify it, because I think it's a marker for other disease. And that's hopefully what I hope to show you today. In this interesting paper, it was interesting to note that it's just not a disease of certain types of countries or certain types of diet, but it's a global process. It involves over 222 million people estimated, and it's increased almost 25% in the last 10 years, maybe related to how we're eating now in the last decade and all the changes that have occurred. So why do we care about PAD? This particular graph looks at quality of life, because I think it's an important number, important thing to think about, right? It's okay, how long are you living, but also what's your quality of life? In this particular graph, if you look way in the right, you talk about an average well adult, they have a number there of 55, an OL projects. Then you have an average adult, may have certain comorbidities, what have you, still 50, you can see how most people fall in that area. But when we start looking at the far left, you start looking at chronic diseases and how they affect your quality of life. We have chronic lung disease and congestive heart failure. Right between those two, we see intermittent claudication or peripheral vascular disease. These are diseases that affect what people need to do every day. And in my office, to me, it's really important. I may have someone that comes to the office and say, you know, I'm having peripheral vascular disease, I have claudication. And really the important thing is to listen to the patient. See exactly how is it affecting their life. Okay? Really, I like to speak to them and say, are you able to do everything that you want to do? And that may be different for different people, right? There may be people that mostly have in their house, check their mail, they may go to the grocery store, and they have a limited type of activity. Other people are very active, right? Help your grandparents, they like to be with their grandkids, they like to do the activities, the family activities, and they may not be able to do that because of their leg pain. And I'm gonna treat those patients differently because it's really trying to keep them and keep people in society, making sure the quality of life is maximized. And I think that's important when we start viewing our risk-benefit analysis of who needs actual treatment and who I'm going to follow. But other than quality of life, I think survival is also important. In this particular graph, we have these green, blue, and red numbers and graphs. And what we see in red are patients that have symptomatic peripheral arterial disease. So these are patients that have claudication, or may have critical limb ischemia. And you can see at the far right their death rate, almost 30%. Asymptomatic is the light blue, or the middle column. And you can see in that graph that if you're asymptomatic with peripheral arterial disease, you're almost just as bad. Your risk of dying, or even on the left side, heart attack, almost just as bad. So when you have patients with peripheral arterial disease, you can almost postulate that they're going to have disease in other arteries. We estimate that about 60 to 80% will have at least one vessel coronary artery disease. If you look at a quarter of them, they have carotid disease. And then when you look at renal disease, subclavian disease, you start also looking at disease in those areas, as well as a propensity for aneurysms and aneurysmal disease, and we'll speak a little bit about that. When you try to put it all together, I think this slide has a lot of different information. But really, one in five patients with peripheral arterial disease will have an MI, will have stroke, cardiovascular death, or hospitalization within 1 year. That's a pretty strong statement. That really tells you exactly what we're looking at in terms of this population. And when you start looking at this population in terms of the management of these patients, you obviously want to prevent amputation, which is one area. You want to improve the quality of life, which I've already discussed about how that important that is. But really, at the top of that pyramid is you want to prevent myocardial infarction, stroke, and death. And that's why we're here today with the Heart Fund Symposium, really trying to do what we can to do that. And how can we do that? When you see patients, we really want to start and never forget about the importance of counseling them on things that people can change. Smoking cessation, probably one of the hardest things for people to do. But it's really important for them to understand how critical it is to reduce that. That increases your risk by 4 to 6 times when you smoke. Antiplatelet therapy, when appropriate, having a daily aspirin therapy. We've discussed already about lipids and the importance of evaluating that type and knowing what people know what numbers they're at and how statins can help them, not only because of the anti-inflammatory process and decreasing the risk of stroke and heart attacks, but also to lower their lipid numbers. Antihypertensive and blood pressure control. Again, one of the few things that we know is directly related to less death related to cardiovascular disease. Exercise. For the first time, the United States is looking at, with new guidelines, that they may cover systematic exercise program in patients with peripheral arterial disease. Because they saw there's definitely a benefit to that. It may even be more beneficial than having to place stents or angioplasties. And then the obvious ones, blood pressure control and nutrition. So who do we treat? Who do I treat? And I've already discussed how important it is to listen to the patient, understand what the patient's symptoms are, what their situation is, look at the risk benefits, what am I really hoping to do with this patient? And determine the levels of disease, because at the levels of disease where if I'm going to do some type of intervention is going to tell me how well they're going to respond for how long. If I have a therapy that I know may have a 90, 80% success rate for 5 years, a lot more likely to do that than when I compare that to a therapy may have a 50% success rate at 1 year. And I try to correlate their symptoms and do I really make them better? A lot of times you see patients and you realize that even if I do something, I'm not going to make them better than they already are. And that's really important to listen to the patient. These are the guidelines that were first published in 2005. 2011, and now they just came out in November of 2016. So who do we treat invasively or minimally invasively now? Really, we look at two patient populations. One is critical limb ischemia, and that's really where we see, I would say, 90% of our growth right now in patients with peripheral arterial disease. We're looking at critical limb ischemia. These are going to be mostly diabetics, patients that are having gangrene or toe ulcers, or patients that are having rest pain. And rest pain is very important. Patients will come to you and say, yeah, and my foot hurts. And really what you need to find out is why is their foot hurt? Is it related to the lack of circulation? Is it related to the fact that they're just not getting enough blood supply to that leg? Typically, the patients will tell you it mostly happens at night. When I lay down, they raise their leg on the bed, and now they no longer have gravity helping pull blood down to the bottom of the foot. And a lot of times they wake up from that pain and they have to dangle their leg from the edge of the bed. That dangling basically helps gravity to bring more blood, arterial blood, to their feet. So you can imagine, going back to that picture I showed you, you have an artery, you have some blockage of that artery or obstruction from that plaque. And when you're at rest, you're doing okay. But you may get to a certain level of that disease where now the amount of blood that's actually going down to that lower extremity is reduced to an extent that even the more minimum amount of blood that you need at rest, you're not able to get. And a lot of them, again, will have this rest pain. So when we look at how critical someone is, rest pain and critical limb ischemia already having gangrene or ulcerations or non-healing ulcerations are pretty much in the area of the patients that we treat. And those are patients that right now we're studying to be the ones that we think we can make the biggest impact because we're trying to prevent amputation in these patients. And then we have the severe claudication. This is still the most controversial group. This is the one where I think not every patient is the same, where we really have to speak to the patient. And I may have a patient with claudication, but they're able to walk a mile. Those patients are probably not going to do some type of invasive therapy. Those I may try to treat with exercise plan, with cilostazole, which is a vasodilator, to see if I can get that patient to get through this without needing an intervention. And the reason is because those interventions, when you look at them 5 years down the road, I can probably look at the patient in the eye and say, you're going to be better in 5 years, 50% of those patients. That may not be good enough. And that's why your technology is important, continuing to improve. There are some patients that can't walk a block. Those are the patients that I want to treat because I know I can make them better. It may only last 5 years, but I'm going to make their quality of life better, and then I can go from there. So how do we evaluate these patients? And I think it's really important to listen to them, a good examination, looking at the risk factors. A pulse examination is really important. If you see a diabetic patient, you have to look at their feet. You have to make sure, do you have any ulcers or ulcerations? Get an idea, you know, do you feel pulses or not? Most of the times you can, and that's great. But when you have a patient, you don't feel pulses, they have the risk factors, you have to think about PAD. And a lot of times the first test is a very easy test, is that ankle brachial index. Basically, a blood pressure of both arms, and you get a blood pressure at the level of the ankle. A lot of times you have to put the actual stethoscope on there. You can't just use the machine. And once you hear that blood pressure in the ankle, you compare both of those, and you get a ratio. And you want that ratio to be about 1. If that ratio drops below 0.9, then you're looking at mild vascular disease. If you're looking at 0.5 below, that's severe vascular disease. And once you do this, you have an idea. Would you see patients with some vascular disease? Then those are the appropriate patients to refer to maybe get an ultrasound and what have you. And what do the ultrasounds do? These non-invasive examinations allows us with the Doppler to look at the velocities within these arteries to assess how bad the arteries may be in terms of blockages. And a lot of times they don't look great. But remember, we're not looking at a 50% stenosis. That usually is not enough to cause someone having severe symptoms. You're looking at something much more severe than that that's really going to give someone symptoms. So the duplex is helpful, but sometimes our non-invasive evaluation, we actually use blood pressure cuffs and look at blood pressures down the leg to get us an idea of really how well someone does. And for our complete examination, we actually walk a patient. So we'll study them at rest, because a lot of times at rest, patients are doing fine. They really have symptoms when they walk. So we may walk them for 5 minutes and then take those pressures again and really get an idea how well they're able to compensate, right? You're able to get enough blood when you're sitting there. But when you start walking and your calf muscles require more oxygen, that's when you start getting the symptoms. And that's where I want to see how well they compensate. Once I see that someone has vascular disease, I have to make that decision. And I don't order a CTA or an MRA or try to get a better look at how bad the disease is until I've made a decision that I think it's worthwhile treating that patient. So if the patient tells me a history of a mile, they're able to walk for a mile, I'm not going to go ahead and proceed with maybe another costly test. I'm able to evaluate that person. I know they have PAD. More importantly, I evaluate them for all those other things we talked about, make sure they're on a statin and make sure they're on those surveillance plans. But I may not go down the road of, we're going to do some kind of procedure on you right now. This is an example of a CT angiogram, and this is someone with severe disease. And this structure here is your aorta. Here's the right kidney, the left kidney. You can see those vessels filling that right kidney and the left kidney right behind there. But this aorta is supposed to come all the way down, and in this case, it's completely occluded. So this is someone who has severe aortoiliac occlusive disease. So again, this is someone we may consider, may have severe symptoms, and may consider for treatment. How do we treat these patients? And really, we're looking at things that you've probably already heard of before. Being able to cross something in an endovascular manner, in other words, minimally invasive through a catheterization, get a wire across that plaque and place a balloon to open that vessel. We now have latest technology where we actually have balloons coated with medications, similar to like the stent medications that are on heart stents, to help reduce restenosis and hope that these treatments last longer. And sometimes these lesions can be really stubborn and we need to place stents. And stents are metallic frameworks that will help support that. So all these are things that we may do. Then there are other types of interventions that we may do to help treat the plaque. We may try to remove the plaque. With this type of atherectomy, sometimes we try to freeze it. There's a lot of things. Sometimes we just have to take it out. And again, here's an example of a carotid artery with plaque, and you can see an open surgical repair by one of my surgical partners. You can see that carotid artery. When you open up that carotid artery and you take out the plaque, this is what that plaque looks like. So that really, this is what we're talking about in terms of peripheral arterial disease. I'd like to start with a case, an 80-year-old female, bilateral claudication, in other words, really bad claudication, worse on the left leg than the right leg. When we studied her, she was able to walk for 5 minutes on this treadmill test, but her numbers on the left leg suggested moderate disease. This is what a non-invasive may show me, and basically looking at the pulsatility at the level of the thigh, you can see that the right leg is almost normal, but the left leg, the pulsatility is much lower. A lot of times I decide I'm going to treat this patient because her symptoms were severe. You can see in the, this is an MRA examination, again, showing us the aorta and the iliac vessels, and we see that there's a blockage here in the origin of that left common iliac artery. When we perform an angiogram, you can see how the MRA correlates really well to the angiogram. So that's why this examination to me is helpful. It allows me to counsel the patient, it allows me to have an idea what procedure I may be doing, so I can assess the risk of those procedures to the patient before I do them. In this particular patient, we place these stents on both iliacs to protect the aorta and both iliacs. And she had a great result. And you can see the comparison between before we treated her and after. So the keys to success to me is really to know your patient. Know when you need to identify peripheral arterial disease, because not everyone's going to come very symptomatic. That's going to be 1 in 1,000. The key is to be able to identify patients at risk and make sure we can treat them early with those preventative medications. I think that's where we're really going to save lives. Abdominal aortic aneurysm disease is another form of vascular disease. And really what happens here is that instead of blocking the artery, the vascular disease affects the wall of the artery and weakens that artory. And by weakening that artery will then dilate. And that's where we get an aneurysm, that dilatation. I tell patients, imagine a balloon. If your vessel turns into a balloon, and as that artery starts dilating, just like a balloon, that wall is getting thinner and thinner. And it gets to a point that it may rupture. What are the risk factors? Surprise, surprise, things that we can control, such as smoking, but there's still other things that we can control, like genetics, which are really important. But I would say smoking, especially patients that have severe COPD, very high risk for aneurysms, as well as patients that are long-term hypertensives. It also is a disease that runs in families, so again, genetics is probably extremely important. When does an aneurysm rupture? I get a lot of calls, a lot of patients see me, doctor, I have this aneurysm, please help me, and you may have a 4-centimeter aneurysm or a 3-centimeter aneurysm. And a lot of times it's important to explain to the patient the risk of doing something is much greater than the risk of that aneurysm rupturing. And sometimes it's difficult for the patient to understand that because they say, wait, this may rupture at any time. So really, a lot of times I take out these kind of charts and I kind of explain to them. I said, your annual risk of rupture of a 4.5-centimeter aneurysm is extremely low, 1 in 200. If I do a procedure, even in best possible hands, you still have a similar type of risk of 1% or less of something. So a lot of times we follow these patients, we really look for a size about 5 to 5.5 centimeters. And what we're trying to do is prevent this. We're trying to prevent death from a ruptured aneurysm. This is an aneurysm that rupturing, you can see blood all in the retroperitoneum. This is an emergency. Most patients will succumb to this process if they have an acute rupture of an aneurysm. So really what you want to do is prevent aneurysm rupture before it ruptures, but you also want to treat patients and treat them with a treatment that may be worse than their actual disease. So we really look at 5 to 5.5 centimeter aneurysms, and we look a little bit lower for women. Women, I think their native arteries are smaller, so you can't use always the same number. A lot of times there's a gray area, right? If I see a patient that has an aneurysm that's grown significantly over the last 6 months, I'm going to be a little bit more aggressive with that patient. If I have a patient that has a family history of a ruptured aneurysm, I'm going to be a little bit more aggressive with that patient. And if I have a female patient that may have smaller arteries, then I'm also going to be more aggressive. So I want to get an idea, how does that compare to their native arteries? Here's an example of an open surgical repair of an aorta. You can see here there's a surgical retractor, and you can see a enlarged aorta. This is an area of ulceration where that aorta was about to rupture. And what a surgeon does to repair these in an open situation is they have to open the aneurysm. That's what you're seeing here, an open aneurysm. And they sew a fake graft or a fake artery, like a plastic artery, at the top and in the bottom. It's as healthy tissue as they can find so that the blood is now flowing from the head across this area and down into this tube. And that's really how you exclude the aneurysm, right? You've taken that weakened part of vessel out of the system so it won't rupture. When we look at endovascular repair, this is something that we've been doing now for about 20 years. You really want to prevent aortic rupture by repairing this aneurysm from the inside out. So here's an example of a CT scan, which allows us to get some measurements of what this aneurysm is like. And what we'll do is we'll place, instead of having to open the patient up and sew the device in, we'll place a device inside that native artery to reinforce the wall from the inside out. And that's what you see here. So you can see here what we've done here is we actually took that patient that had that aneurysm and placed a graft. So what you're seeing here is that same kind of graft material that's supported by stents. And now the contrast or the blood flow is going through the aorta and going from one leg to the other. And that area of aorta that was weakened has now been excluded. So there's no pressure in that aneurysm and there's no risk of rupture. So instead of having to open patients, now we treat them endovascularly. This is the treatment that we're doing now for most patients for this type of disease. And you can see as we follow these patients, you start seeing reduction of the aneurysm size. And usually these patients will get followed at least once a year once they have this type of technology. Another pathology of the aorta, sometimes you get dissections of the aorta. And dissections, really, you're looking at some weakness in the wall that may cause a small rent in one of the walls of the aorta, usually that inner wall, the intima. And you can get blood to leak in between the two layers of the aortic wall. And that's what we're seeing here, is a true lumen, which complete aorta here in the ascending aorta, and then you see this dissection, in this case, extends all the way into the iliac arteries. And our treatment of these dissections has also improved. Here's a patient that presents, a 48-year-old male, presented with severe back pain, had a CT scan and showed this dissection of the descending thoracic aorta, so below the aortic arch. This particular patient went ahead and got an angiogram. You can see how well it correlates to the CT scan that he had earlier in the day. Then we use other types of technology, such as an intravascular ultrasound, to identify this true lumen, which is being compressed, and that false lumen, to be able to then place a stent graft, or again, that same covered type of technology, to exclude that lumen that was the dissection. So wherever that dissection started, we're able to treat that. And this is an area that also we've changed the way we're treating these patients. Traditionally, we treated patients with type B dissections medically, and we watched them. But what we've learned is that patients that are treated medically still have a high chance of mortality and requiring new and more procedures. So we're being much more aggressive with these patients. So when we place these grafts, we basically exclude that other lumen, that area of dissection, and this area of thrombosis. And we know that if we can get this false lumen to close off or to thrombose, these patients do much better. This is an article that came from the Massachusetts General Hospital, published about 2 years ago. And they looked at their patients that were treated with early treatment compared to just medical management. And they saw that the majority of patients with acute type B dissections that were treated medically failed medical therapy in a 6-year period with only an intervention-free survival of 41%. So about 59% of these patients needed some other procedure. And that's why we treated them with these procedures earlier. And I still think this is an area that we're studying. We're trying to learn which patients we need to treat and when. But really, we found out that dissections are something difficult to treat and something that we're being a lot more aggressive with these type of therapies. And this is just a graph showing patients that were treated with intervention are doing much better, especially 6 years out, compared to open repair. Can we predict which patients we need to treat? And that's really an area of research, right? So we're trying to figure out which patients do we need to treat. So this is a patient with a very interesting condition we've already heard of. So you can see that the ascending aorta, you don't really see a sinal tubule ridge, and this basically looks like a tulip bulb. This is a patient with Marfan syndrome. So we see a patient like this. This is someone who has a collagen disorder, genetic situation. We're going to treat this patient differently. We're not going to place a graft in that patient. And this is a patient at high risk of developing a dissection of the ascending aorta. Other patients, we may then perform 4D MRIs. MRIs are going to look at the flow to try to give us some idea. Is this patient at a higher risk or not? And there's a lot of different publications, again, trying to evaluate which patients with dissections we need to treat and how can we identify those patients. So the last part of my talk, I really want to speak about two different things, which are really technology. And I told you about aneurysms, and one of the new technology that we have is really how to treat aneurysms in a different way. I gave you the idea that when we fix aneurysms, we basically try to place that graft to exclude and create a new way, a new form of filling and making the blood go through the inside through a more structured and a more reinforced vessel. Unfortunately, those may have some type of endoleaks, or what we call leaks, or native vessels that still may fill the sac. A new novel technology involves using bags, or endobags, which we see here. And these endobags we fill with a polymer, so we fill the entire aneurysm with a polymer so that there's no chance of having an endoleak. This is one of the new technologies that we were involved with the trial here in the United States. It's still not FDA approved. But what we do is we place, instead of having to place those big devices, we place two smaller stents, and these stents are lined with these bags. And we're able to fill these bags with a polymer so that once you place these bags in and you place the polymer and you finish injecting, you have this same appearance where the contrast is not flowing down to both legs. But in here, instead of just having an empty sac, you now have a polymer-filled sac. And that polymer prevents from other vessels coming in and creating some form of an endoleak. You can see the type of results of what we may get in these type of patients. And again, this is still in study. We're involved in enrolling a lot of patients in the United States trial. Right now, they're trying to evaluate in terms of that this type of new technology being approved for treatment of our patients. Gives you, again, some ideas of how that works. Again, here, excluding the aneurysm with these sacs. I told you a little bit about this new center. And, you know, the outside of the building is great, but I think what we really want to do on the inside of the building is have programs to really improve the treatment of our patients and the education of our entire team. And one of the things that we have are these advanced endovascular therapy areas. You can see here these are large, you know, almost ceiling to floor windows, and we have seating outside where we can be watching and we can be interacting and seeing what's going on inside. And this just gives you an idea of a complex procedure that we're undergoing and how many people are in the room. And we're out here, people are out watching and seeing what's going on. So a lot of interaction. Again, you can see an idea of what these suites look like and these chairs outside with a lot of interaction, really helping us to try to get the best technology, but also the best kind of interaction and communication so that everyone is involved in these cases. And technology really has changed in the last decade. We went from an X-ray system, which is really a two-dimensional flat picture, to really looking at a volume of information. And, you know, CT scans really helped us out with that. Being able to, you acquire a CT and now you have all these slices, you're able to create these reconstructions so we can look at things in three dimensions. So in this particular patient that presents with a renal aneurysm, it's supposed to spin around, but you can see this blue thing here is that aneurysm in this angiogram of the kidneys. And we first started by being able to inject contrast and create this 3D model, which then allowed us, instead of having to inject contrast five or six times to try to see where this aneurysm was, I can inject contrast once, create a 3D model right at the table, and figure out what angles I needed to treat that aneurysm and better study it. Then the next step was, well, if I can get these 3D images, why can't I use that image right at the time of therapy to help me perform better treatments? And you can see in this particular patient that had some problems with a renal insufficiency, I really couldn't inject too much contrast. I create this angiogram. It shows me that this patient has a large aneurysm of the hypogastric artery. And my goal was to fill and block this artery here with coils and try to block it so that it won't rupture. I was able to create this with one image, create a 3D model, real time, superimposed on my treatment. And then I could just use this to basically guide me to find out where the artery was, to go ahead and then treat the patient. And this is something in 3D, so this could actually be moving right now, and I can show you real time. I can move the II, move my imaging equipment, and everything moves together. It gives me a 3D perspective. The next step from that is, well, if I can do it on the table, why can't I bring a CT the patient had a week ago and use that for her imaging? And that's one of the things we can do. So this is a patient that could be coming to have an aneurysm repair, and I can take the CT that the patient had 3 months ago, superimpose it on the patient. And as I'm treating the patient, instead of just looking at a screen like this with my wire, I can actually be seeing a screen and seeing the arteries next to them without having to inject any more contrast. So it gives us the ability to perform a lot of these procedures without needing to inject more contrast and really having pretty much a roadmap, almost like a GPS of where I'm going in that aneurysm. We use this really, it's critical when we start doing more complicated cases. So sometimes we have to perform AAA repairs where we actually have to get into the renal arteries to help stent the renal arteries because we need to really go and involve the renal arteries. And a lot of times in these patients, we can do fenestrated grafts such as this. So this is a patient that has an aneurysm, but the aneurysm extends almost to the level of the renal arteries. Traditionally, this would be something that would require surgery. We now have stent grafts that allow us to have small holes or fenestra within the stent graft so that we can then place stents through those holes into the kidneys and create a seal up above the renal artery level. And a lot of times we use this type of fusion technology to help us acquire and perform those type of procedures such as this. Other things we can do is now that you've created a 3D space and you're working in a 3D space, you can consider using devices that will be smart in this 3D space. So you can be in this 3D space, I have a map, I have a GPS, well maybe my catheters can have some kind of device on them that I can then co-register them. So I could use a robot to get my catheter where I need to go. I can really help in terms of being even more precise. And that's really what we think is going to be the future, being able to use robotics to help follow and being sitting outside the room or right next to the room and being able to drive our catheters using robotics and our overlay feature. Taking that one step further, we can make 3D models. So in this particular patient, we're going to fix an aneurysm. But you can imagine looking at a pediatric heart in front of you before you go treat it, and you know exactly where the pathology is. And then what we can do is take that same information that we used to do a 3D model, and we can put it into a simulator. So you can put it into a simulator, hopefully improve your results and your treatment of patients. Because I may, instead of doing that case for the first time on my patient, I could have practiced it two or three times beforehand, and I know exactly where the difficult parts are going to be and what kind of devices I need to have the best type of therapies. And we think this is going to improve not only safety, but also education and financial burden in terms of what we're doing. You can see here a particular patient that we were going ahead and we did our simulation. We have our model. We're looking at the screen. And this is a movie, but it's not running. But basically, in this movie, we basically showed you that we did every step that we would do for an aneurysm repair table side on the simulator. So when we came to do it, we knew exactly what kind of devices we were going to have, what kind of angle we wanted to use. So instead of, you know, we reduced the time that we're doing this procedure, we're being able to be more effective and get better results. So in conclusion, I want to say that, first of all, vascular disease is important. It shows us really what's going on in the heart, that our bodies are all together. Things that involve the heart can also involve a peripheral arterial disease. It's the same type of process, same type of disease. Patients may just manifest symptoms in other areas. So it's important that when we have patients that have risk factors, to evaluate them for peripheral arterial disease. Once we make the diagnosis of peripheral arterial disease, be able to give them prevention so that we can prevent heart attack and stroke, because that's still what our patients are going to die of. Small amount of patients, we have to worry about claudication and critical limb ischemia and amputation. And I think it's important to listen to our patients so we know which ones we need to treat. And then when we're going to treat them, then we have all these tools that I told you about. Technology is really fantastic for those particular patients to help us increase our results and get better results for our patients. Thank you.
Pleasant good night to everyone. I hope we're not under the influence of the wonderful food and alcohol provided at the back. Thanks to Dr. Bahara and her team for giving me the opportunity to speak to you. on the Cayman experience as it regards the... as it regards the management of acute ischemic stroke. Thank you. Now we're going to take a look at some stroke statistics. Now 87% of all strokes are ischemic and the remaining 30% being hemorrhagic. The important line here is that early action is important in stroke. Time is definitely brain. Now, the CDC conducted a survey in which 13 states in the United States were involved, and they found that only 38% of persons were aware of the major symptoms of a stroke. And that's a problem for us, since we're advocating early presentation to make you eligible for the thrombolytics. Now, patients who arrive in the emergency room within 3 hours of their first symptoms will receive thrombolytics. And these patients will have, in 3 months, post the stroke, less disability than those who receive delayed care. And this was done by the National Institute of Neurological Disorders and Stroke. Now, the protocol for treatment of acute ischemic stroke has definitely been revolutionized by the ECAS study. Initially, we had a window period of up to 3 hours, and this study have actually allowed us now to treat patients who present in up to 4.5 hours of the first onset of their symptoms. Now, the Cayman experience, with the advent of thrombolytics, we are seeing very good results with our stroke patients, and this is mainly patients who present to the Health Services Authority. In September of 2014, we had our stroke protocol in place, and by that time we were now classified as a primary stroke center. We have embarked on a number of public awareness campaigns, both on television and on the radio, to allow patients to recognize that this new treatment is available on island, that we do can administer intravenous alteplase. Now this is just to show you our Stroke Council, August 2014, we had our internists, radiologists, neurosurgeons, emergency room physician, and our critical care nurse manager. Our acute stroke team on a day-to-day basis will consist of our EMS, or emergency service personnel, the emergency room physician and nurses, on-call radiologists, internists, neurosurgeon, CCU nurses, and our laboratory technicians. Now, all the HSA physicians involved in the management of patients with stroke were trained on how to quickly administer the stroke scale, the National Institute of Health Stroke Scale, NIHSS, and we were also certified online. Now, the critical care unit staff and the medical ward staff was also trained in how to administer the stroke scale. Now, once a patient calls 911 or present to the emergency room with any symptoms in keeping with acute stroke, we first want to identify the time frame. Once the patient falls within the 3-hour time frame, the patient is quickly moved to the CT suite, then the scale is calculated, then a short relevant history is taken, and then we want to know what is the PT-INR samples so we can move along to administer our drug. Now, alteplase is still the most commonly, almost the only drug that is still being used in acute stroke. There have been some talks about tenecteplase, metalized, being used. Again, the studies show that there was some benefit with metalized, but the patients that were used in the study, they expanded the time window to 6 hours outside of the 4.5 hours, and hence those persons had a great percentage of intracranial hemorrhage. So once the patients meet the criteria and we calculate the dose, 10% is given in 1 minute, 90% over an hour, and then we have our checks. These patients are admitted to the critical care unit for monitoring. This is an example of what it looks like. It's usually a brightly colored yellow to orange protocol form that can be seen easily. And we have a reminder of the exclusion and exclusion criteria for the 3 hours and the 3.5 hours. I guess they don't want us to talk about stroke today. Okay. All right. Now, for our Cayman experience, we decided to do a short audit just to give us an example as to the impact that TPA has on the morbidity and mortality for stroke patients. We had 25 patients. Good news is that almost 45% of our patients presented on time within the 3 hour window. Bad news, 55% of our patients did not receive TPA. Unfortunately, most of them didn't realize they were having a stroke. Most of them didn't realize to call 911 on time, and therefore they could not benefit from TPA. Of the 45% of the patients who received TPA, the 90-day mortality was 0%, which is excellent for us. And the discharge functional state, all patients return to their normal baseline post-TPA upon discharge. Now, I want to take your attention to the wake-up stroke. There have been lots of talk as to patient being excluded from receiving TPA because of the time of onset being unknown. So these patients, they'll be last seen a couple of hours well prior to bedtime, and then they will wake up in the morning with weakness. And the Mr. Witness trial have allowed us now to be able to identify if those patients still fall within the 3 to 4.5-hour window period to receive TPA. The advent of the use of MRI in stroke therapy have definitely allowed us to be able to categorize these patients. So the patient will get a CT scan of the brain offset just to make sure there is no intracranial hemorrhage. Then they will be moved to the MRI of the brain. Now there are two sequences that should be done, the DWI and the FLAIR. Okay, still not up. Now the DWI, okay, good. Now the, okay, wonderful. All right, so we can basically skip this. This was just to let you know 20% of patients with stroke definitely fall in the wake-up stroke category. All right, good. Now the DWI, which is a diffusion-weighted imaging, is a very wonderful technology that can allow us to give us an idea of the age of the infarct, because remember, we want to see if the infarct falls within the 3 to 4.5 hours. The other important MRI test that should be done is the FLAIR MRI. And I want to highlight for the physicians that are in the room that a patient with an acute stroke that falls in the wake-up category can receive intravenous thrombolytic if their DWI is positive and the FLAIR is negative, because the FLAIR will take 4 to 6 hours to become positive. So once it is negative, we know you're in the window and you can receive thrombolytics. And this was the trial. So the trial, the Mr. Witness trial, it was an open label phase 2 single arm study, about 80 patients. They were given TPA if they present less than the 4.5 hours of symptom discovery. And they had their MRI. These patients had to be DWI positive and FLAIR negative. All right, these patients should not have any of the other exclusion criteria that would usually classify them as not being able to get TPA, apart from unknown time of onset. Now, the trial concluded that TPA is safe and feasible in selected patients treated within the 4.5 hours of symptom discovery now, not the onset of symptom, but symptom discovery. The response rates were similar to those seen in patients who had their first symptom within the 3 to 4.5 hours. Now, we have a larger study going on because, as you can see, this was just 80 patients. It was really a small study, but still gave us some interesting data. Now, we spoke about this, so we can skip this. Good. All right, so the take-home message today is that time is brain. Each hour in which treatment fails to occur, the brain loses as many neurons as it does in almost 3.6 years of normal aging. There is still a lot to be done with patient education. As mentioned, 55% of the patients on island still presents late with a stroke. And most of them actually did not even realize they were having a stroke. A more extensive study needs to be done. As you see, the data that was presented was mainly US. We still don't have any data here on island as to the incidence, prevalence, mortality rate concerning stroke, the type of strokes that are seen here on island. And this brings me to my last point, that we're in the process of establishing a stroke registry that will be able to allow us now to have our own data so we can match our patients, we can see how well we're doing with TPA. We can also be able to make other protocols as it regards physiotherapy post-stroke, in terms of speech therapy post-stroke. So this is an important venture that we would like to march out on to get our stroke registry on before the closing of this year. Thank you so very much.